Hi, Jonathan Hall here. This video is going to be different than anything I've ever done before. I'm going to be doing a commentary on an episode of Star Trek: The Next Generation. I'm doing the commentary through the lens of DevOps practices, if you will. I'm going to comment on some of their problem-solving approaches and how I would probably have done things differently. If you find this interesting, be sure to like the video. If you'd like to see more like this, make a suggestion for an episode of a TV show or a movie you'd like to see this sort of commentary on. Do that in the comments below. But let's get started. So the episode I'm commenting on comes from the first season of Star Trek: The Next Generation. If you've watched the show as I did when I was younger, this episode I found to be kind of awe-inspiring at the time. Looking back, I'm much more critical of it. I hope I don't spoil anything for you. The basic plot is that they're doing some warp experiments that go wrong, and the Enterprise ends up in a faraway galaxy. They don't know why, and they try to, of course, get back home. They make things worse in the process. Eventually, of course, they do get back home. Let's dive in.
Captain's log, stardate 41263.1. We have rendezvoused with the USS Fearless, from which a Starfleet propulsion expert and his assistant are beaming over to conduct tests on the Enterprise's warp drive engines.
I don't understand your concern, Number One. They're not authorized to make any alterations in our engines. According to Starfleet's report, they will simply run tests on different ways of entering warp speed and different intermix formulas. Where's the harm in that?
It's the specs Kaczynski sent us. In my opinion, sir, they're gibberish.
So right here from the beginning, we can see that they're setting the stage for this experimental warp drive thing they're going to be doing. Riker has concerns. He thinks that the guy coming to do it is full of crap. Picard trusts his credentials from Starfleet. Let's see what happens. Now we finally get to meet the warp experimenting guy, Mr. Kaczynski. First officer, Commander William Riker.
And this is...
Where is the captain, please?
He's engaged in other duties, sir.
A ship's engines should be the concern of a ship's captain.
I'll have our chief engineer show you to his engine room.
No need. I know my way around starships.
One thing that Kaczynski isn't hiding is bad disposition.
Agreed. Also, he's arrogant, overbearing, self-important, and very sure of himself and his ability.
Remind you of anyone you've worked with?
Before you begin, there are some questions. First, tell us how you arrived.
In order to save myself time, let me ask those questions for you. You see, I have had this conversation on other Starfleet vessels before. They didn't understand it. Why should you?
Surely you're not saying it's unexplainable.
I am saying I'm not a teacher, nor do I wish to become one. I have neither the inclination nor the time.
So here's another typical sort of cowboy coder attitude I suppose we see a lot, the arrogance and unwillingness to help other people.
So, here then, in the simplest possible terms, is what I do.
I just want to comment that I think it's really interesting here that they're doing this experiment essentially in production. You would think that some sort of highly experimental warp thing, they would test in a lab on an unmanned spacecraft. Why are they doing this on a vessel with 1,000+ people? This doesn't make any sense. But they're off on a really bad foot to begin with, doing experimental changes in a production environment.
Can anything he's proposing damage our system?
How could it? It's meaningless.
So here, Riker is acting as, I guess, our product manager or product owner in this situation. And he's making the decision to go forward with this experiment. A dubious decision, in my view. He should insist that they not do this on a production starship with people on it. They should do this test on an unmanned craft in laboratory conditions. Have it proven beyond any doubt before they test it on manned vehicles. It's just kind of ridiculous. You don't do experiments in production.
You ready? We are.
So they made the decision to do the experiment, despite how foolish it is. But they don't seem to have any sort of contingency plan in place. They're just winging it, playing it by ear. When things go wrong, as we see here in a moment, they don't know what to do. They just stop. They don't have any incident response or emergency response in place. It's pretty chaotic.
What are you doing?
Captain, we're passing warp 10.
Reverse engines.
Captain, no one has ever reversed engines at this velocity.
Because no one has gone this fast. Reverse engines.
It doesn't strike me as a very compelling reason to throw caution to the wind.
All stop. Position.
The galaxy known as M33.
So the incident has now occurred. They're trying to evaluate what exactly has happened. They're just trying to determine the impact, which is, of course, an important thing to do when an incident happens in your software project.
And I calculate that at maximum warp, sir, it would take over 300 years to get home.
So we're about to witness the, if we can call it, postmortem for this event, where they try to determine what happened and next steps.
Captain Picard, I presume.
We're still trying to determine what happens.
The truth is, Captain, I made a mistake.
Just explain what brought us here.
As the power grew, I applied the energy asymptomatically. I anticipated some tilling, but it didn't occur. Now that was my error, using the Bessel functions at the beginning.
What is he saying, number one? To tell the truth, sir, it sounds like nonsense to me, but Considering.
So they didn't really do a proper postmortem. They didn't do any root cause analysis. They proposed a theory, and they've accepted that theory as fact because of where they are. They haven't considered alternative theories. That's ridiculous. These are supposed to be scientists. Data is sitting right there. He's pretty nitpicky about this. He should be complaining.
Yes, but isn't the real point? Can you do it again?
So they're not complete imbeciles. They clearly want to repeat the same results. They should have just done that before they did it in production.
Captain, can you allow a man who's made one mistake back into a position where he may make another?
In general, I disagree with Worf's approach here. Just because somebody's made a mistake doesn't mean you shouldn't allow them again. Of course, that assumes that they are learning from their mistakes. We don't necessarily have evidence that Kaczynski has learned from his mistake. In fact, he seems quite confident of himself, despite having just admitted to making a mistake. So he probably has a good point here.
I know that if Kaczynski can get us home, Starfleet can use his technique to bring back a pure science vessel.
So here Picard finally admits that it is not appropriate for the Enterprise to be doing this sort of experimental behavior. That if the experiment proves successful, others can return and take readings in this new galaxy or whatever. They should have realized this before and just not done this experiment at all with the Enterprise.
I don't think he did this. I think
not
that
now,
it was...
Wes.
Standing by, number one.
But sir, when all this happened, I was watching his assistant.
I'm sure this is fascinating, Wesley, and I am looking forward to hearing all about it, but not right now.
So as much as I like Riker, in this case, he's acting like a hippo. He's ignoring all except the most highly paid person's opinion. He doesn't view Wesley as worth listening to.
We're ready for you to engage, Captain.
As before, begin at warp 1.5.
This isn't working.
Stop.
Answering all stop, Captain.
But where is this place?
So now the second iteration of the experiment has failed. Let's jump to basically their second postmortem and see what they do.
What did you do?
It wasn't him. It never was. It was his assistant.
What are you talking about?
Kaczynski wasn't the one controlling the warp experiments.
It was me!
The equations he punched in were nonsense, just as we thought.
It was also my fault, Captain. I should have realized it wasn't Kaczynski.
How could you? How could any of us?
In this second postmortem, they jump past all the root cause analysis and they've already determined the root cause is the Traveler. This isn't a very good example of a blameless postmortem, though. The chief engineer accepts blame. They're pointing fingers at Kaczynski. A good postmortem seeks to find answers without placing blame. Even accepting blame on oneself is frowned upon in a blameless postmortem.
Wesley did.
If you knew something, why didn't you say so?
He tried. Twice. I didn't listen.
We have no choice but to repeat the same warp experiment, but with one variation. A principal part of this warp formula will be the thoughts of everyone aboard the Enterprise. We have no idea exactly how this works. We understand only that the Traveler makes use of this somehow. Engage.
Warp 1.5, sir. Which is what my instruments have read all along.
Captain's log, stardate 41263.4. For outstanding performance in the best Starfleet tradition, Wesley Crusher is made acting ensign with the duties and privileges of that rank.
So in the end, the Enterprise gets back home happily, despite being very foolish. Wesley Crusher gets a promotion in recognition of his work, and I suppose Kaczynski goes on and maybe learns a little bit of humility. So I'm going to conclude with my own postmortem of this episode and the things that I think that the Enterprise crew could do to help reduce the chance and the impact of such an incident happening in the future. So the first part of a postmortem is to describe the incident. Here, the Enterprise is warped to some unintentional location. We want to record the start and end times and the impact. During the incident, the impact was pretty large. You know, the crew was essentially lost. But, of course, by the end of the episode, the impact was essentially nothing, as is always the case on episodic shows like this. Then to do our own root cause analysis of the problem, of course, we start with the problem. The Enterprise is warped to some other location. Then we throw out some potential causes. Of course, the one that was presented in the episode was the misuse of a Bessel function in a warp calculation, whatever that means. They ruled it out. The actual root cause was some sort of thought interference in the warp calculation. How can we remediate this or prevent this from happening in the future? The most obvious and the thing I've been saying all along is don't do warp experiments on populated ships. We could also do a proper root cause analysis when something like this does happen, rather than just jumping to conclusions, as I'd already commented on. And we could listen to everybody in the room, not just the people who feel like they're more powerful. And of course, I think that the Enterprise should implement a blameless postmortem culture to do the exact process I'm doing right now. It's always good, of course, in a postmortem to mention the things that went well during the incident, and there were a few here. The obvious one is that the Traveler was able to help them to return home. And, of course, Wesley finally got recognized for his contribution. So that's all I have for this video. I hope you've enjoyed this experiment of my own on doing postmortems about television. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Until next time.